Good morning, everybody. Welcome. So thankful to have all of you here in Farmington with us this morning. Thanks for making the trip. Thanks for saving me the trip to some other place this time. It's great to be able to host you and have you here in Farmington and to have you in the Land of Enchantment, you know, our only congregation in our district that is in New Mexico. So thanks for coming. It's good to have you all here. God's word that we're going to focus on today takes us through our theme this morning. We believe, therefore we speak. That's the focus for our conference these next 2 days. And as we listen to God's words, we hear from Moses and we hear from Paul and we hear from Jesus how the things that we have in our hearts also need to come out our mouths so that other people can hear them. And so our opening hymn this morning is, We All Believe in One True God. It's a version by Sarah Lambrecht, who is not unknown to our district and to this circuit. We were thankful to have her here. And so we'll be joining in this hymn. It's a new one to us here at Christ the Rock. It's probably new to you too, but she'll be singing it for us so we can join in singing with her.
True God, who created earth and heaven, the Father who to us in love
has the right of children given, He in soul and body feeds us, for we need His hand provides us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
As I live, declares the Lord of armies, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that they turn from their way and live. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Today our attention is focused on the treasure we carry with us and confess, Jesus Christ. So let's take a quiet moment for reflection and self-examination. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in our thinking, in our speaking, and in our doing. We have taken what belongs to you and used it selfishly. We have wasted this treasure you have poured into us. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and call us by your Holy Spirit to the new life you ordained for us, to the glory of your holy name. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. Thanks to Jesus, I can assure you that your sins are forgiven. Amen. Let's join in our song of praise. To God on high be glory.
To God on high be glory and peace to all the earth.
For God has shown his favor in Jesus' holy birth. Almighty God and Father, our humble thanks we bring. We worship you. Bless you, Lord God, our heavenly King. Lamb of God, exalted, you take all sin away. Extend to us your mercy and hear us as we pray.
We join together in our responsive prayer of the day. Almighty God, you have always given your church faithful shepherds
to feed and nourish your flocks.
Guide your called servants to rightly preach your word and administer your sacraments.
And through them guide your people in the way that leads to eternal life.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. God equips Moses, even as he calls him, to take what's in his heart and to be able to express it to his people, Israel, so that he will be able to tell them who has called him and the purpose for which he was sent. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, "I'll go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up." When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, "Moses, Moses." And Moses said, "Here I am." "Do not come any closer," God said. "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground." Then he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, What is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, Say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation. This is the word of our Lord. Let's join together in singing our Alleluias, our Praise the Lord. Alleluia, Alleluia, the Lord our God be praised. Alleluia, Alleluia, your word brings righteousness. With all your works we praise you, exalt your name forever. Alleluia, Alleluia, sing Alleluia. Our gospel this morning is from Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 through 20. In this section, Jesus sends out his disciples, but also reminds them that he will send his Holy Spirit, who will give them the words that they can share. So let's view Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 through 20. This is the gospel, the good news of our Savior Jesus. Praise be to you, O Christ. We'll continue with our next hymn, By Faith. We see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove his faithfulness, who walk by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers roamed the earth, with the power of his promise in their hearts.
Send us children of the
God bless your message.
Good morning, Christians.
Morning.
God's word for our meditation, set aside by our leaders, are printed before us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 18. There we read, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. It is written, 'I believe, therefore I have spoken.' Since we have that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." God's word. Do we love to talk? I think it's part of the profession in a way, but it's not just true of us who are gathered here this day. People tend to love to talk. You know, we meet somebody, we get some impressions, we mix in a few facts, a little bit of experience, a little bit of talk, a little bit of gossip, and then we leap and speak. And it doesn't matter how accurate our words are about that person or this person, they always tend, for some reason, to make us look good, make us feel better about ourselves. We have this tendency to do that, and it's nothing new 2,000 years ago. What is with this guy? Five times, 40 minus one lashes? Seriously? You know why the Romans whipped somebody 39 times? Because 40 would often kill them. And with the corpse comes paperwork. They didn't want that. But do the math. Five times 40, 200 minus five, 195 times. What did Paul's back look like? He was beaten with rods? That's got to leave him. Imprisoned too many times to even record. I wonder if it's ever happened before. He was stoned and left for dead. What was that like? A half hour later, he comes to and broken ribs and broken bones and contusions. He crawls out of that pyre of rock and goes back to preaching the gospel. I mean, seriously, this guy claims to be working for Jesus. This guy claims to be an apostle of Christ. People talk. And we talk too, don't we? What's going on with that guy? What's happening over there? Too often we sound like Job's quote-unquote friends. I think you're doing something wrong if you're suffering like this, right? And even those words tend to make us feel a little better about ourselves. People love to talk about others. Well, my friends, people also love to talk about themselves. You go to a dinner party every now and then. Years ago, I would get invited to a corporate dinner party, and there you'd mix with the well-to-do, and they would be quick to tell you how well they were to do and how successful they are and the wonderful things that they have, and the wonderful places they go and how their children are so exceptional and successful too. That may be true of them, but it's kind of true of me and you. When we hear conversations, we love to leap and pounce into them and say, I've got a story to tell too. And that story tends to make us look good or wise or humorous, at the very least. People love to talk about themselves. And the Apostle Paul in this section talks quite a lot about himself, but the way he talks about himself is quite the opposite of the way we tend to talk about ourselves. He is defending in his ministry. He is being attacked and talked about. So he does defend his ministry, but he does so by focusing on the one who called and commissioned him rather than himself. And he does talk about himself, but he doesn't talk about himself in a way that brings glory to himself. Rather, he talks about the hope that he has in someone outside of himself. Hope. What is hope? Kind of the engine that drives us, isn't it? It's what makes us say what we say. It makes us do what we do. It's what gets us out of bed in the morning. It's what directs our efforts in our lives. Hope is what drives. And Paul says, if your hope is in the right place, you can endure suffering. Hope's hard to pin down. A story I stole goes like this. There were two young women that graduated from the University of Colorado. Top of their law class, and they were determined not to just get a job, but to work for one of the top law firms in the nation. While their classmates were getting jobs, they applied to the top five law firms in the nation. And both received word back from one, Sullivan Cromwell, New York City. One girl got a letter saying she was welcome to come out there and serve a 1-year unpaid internship. So she packed up her Subaru and headed east. And the other girl on top of her class got an offer from Sullivan and Cromwell, not a job, the same thing, come serve as an intern. The girl gets to New York and she meets one of the partners, and the partner says, what can I tell you? I mean, we can tell academically you can fit here, but we need to find out what you're made of. So I don't know how you're gonna live, I don't know where you're gonna live, you're not gonna get a cent from us. But every partner will have on speed dial your phone number, and when they call you, you respond, I don't care when it is, what it's for, do research, bring coffee, 1 year, you survive, and this is what you get. A high six-figure salary, your own office, and it's nowhere but up from there. The second girl that goes to the law firm in Chicago tries to meet with one of the partners, but the partner doesn't show up, and the secretary takes her to HR, where a manager sits down and says essentially the same thing. Your life is going to be a living hell for 1 year, but if you survive, you'll get an interview. Two different outcomes. The Subaru is going to stay in New York. The Volkswagen in Chicago is going to be heading back west in a couple weeks. What our ultimate hope is what drives us. And Paul says that does change everything, because suffering is a big part of life. And it shouldn't shock us, it's inevitable. He says in verse 16, we're wasting away. From the day we're born, we're not born with an electric clock, an electric ticker. We got the wind-up kind. And when it ticks down, we're done. That's it. We're broken people in a broken and fallen world. It's odd that suffering should shock us. But too often it does. It's inevitable. But it also follows a pattern. It follows a pattern patterned after the one on whom our hope is set. Jesus was a man of suffering, acquainted with suffering, and he suffered. And through his torturous death came resurrection, ascension, and now the name that is of all names. He rules and reigns forever. At his name, every knee will bow from such suffering to such glory. Paul dares to tie that into his life and into ours. He says there's a pattern here. His ministry is no less apostolic because of his suffering, but his suffering actually confirms his ministry. And through his suffering in life, through his imprisonment, through his stonings and his beatings, he is bringing life to bear in the souls and hearts of others. And that is ministry. Inwardly, suffering causes perseverance, perseverance, character, character, hope. But outwardly, our suffering bears fruit and brings life in the souls of other people. Through death comes resurrection. Through going down, we bring other people up. And with that pattern, we can understand what Paul is saying in verses 8 through 10. It makes sense. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair, even though we feel despair at times. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that by his life, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. So this is going somewhere. This hope is pointing to the future. In verse 14, we read these words. Because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. So what is our hope? And we say, well, our hope is to be with Jesus. Our hope is heaven. And heaven is beautiful. It is our hope. But sometimes we think of heaven as a consolation for all the sufferings and the troubles we have here. But our hope is beyond that. Panagenesia. The renewal of all things. A new heaven, a new earth, a new body, a new brain, yet our brain, me, you, together, physical with Jesus, reigning and ruling with him for eternity in a glory that no preacher can express, no heart can contain. This is the hope that drives us. This is what moves us. This is what gives us the ability to endure suffering. And finally, people. We do love to talk. So talk. Talk about the hope. The hope that you have. This is what the world needs. If you have the right hope, not only can you endure, but you can also speak. My fellow jars of clay, from dust you were created, to dust you will return, but we are not dust in the wind, we are vessels. And vessels hold something. The message of Christ crucified for sinners. And the reason we are these jars of clay is to pour that message out everywhere. We, too, are interns. Our law firm, stricken, smitten, and afflicted. I heard somebody say, worst law firm ever. But it's the most fantastic law firm there is. And we're interns, and days are hard, and ministry is difficult, and people hard to deal with. The hours are long, yet what's coming is so absolutely astounding that they make our present sufferings not even measurable. They don't even cross the scale compared compared to the glory that will be revealed in us through Jesus Christ. Ole was a farmer in Minnesota, and he loved the opera. He was a bachelor. He didn't spend money on himself. He worked hard. But any money he had, he would spend going into the Twin Cities to take in operas. And there was a Russian woman by the name of Anna, who was Don Carlos with the opera, and she was the lead soprano, and he was front and center on opening night. And when she sang, it just melted his heart. Even when people were leaving, he was like sobbing. So he kept coming back for every performance. He would bring roses. He would leave them at the ticket booth for Anna, the soprano. He would be there front and center, and she noticed. And a time later, they met, and they dated, and they got to know one another, and he proposed to her. She said yes. On the wedding night, in the honeymoon suite, Ole witnessed Anna, the beautiful soprano, pull off her wig, pull up her eyelashes, popped up her right eye, put it in an ashtray, took out her false teeth, unstrapped her false leg, and Ole cried out, Ole cried out, sing, Anna, sing. If you remember that, remember this, speak, Christian. They won't listen. That guy is on his headphones next to me on the plane. He doesn't want to hear what I have to say. Maybe not. But preaching is not a part-time gig. Witnessing is not something that we do occasionally and for the right people. Speak. Christians speak. We believe, therefore we speak. God bless our conference.
With these words that we've heard and the faith in our hearts, now we have the chance to speak together the words of the Nicene Creed. You can find that on page 10 in your service folder. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. This time we have the opportunity to express our faith with our gifts of thanksgiving. Would you please stand and join me in prayer? Lord Jesus, as we gather for our conference this morning, we are once again reminded of how much we need you poured out into us through the gift of the Spirit, how we need your words to come from our lips, to connect with people, to share with them the incredible news of what you've done and the hope that we have. So Lord, guide us in our time together today. Encourage us by your Spirit. Fill us once again with your words of hope and promise and peace and joy. And then, Lord, fill us with that excitement and thankfulness to go out and speak to others, to speak our hearts, to speak your heart and the hope that we have. We ask all these things in your name as we join together in the prayer that you taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. We'll continue with our communion liturgy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who promised that wherever two or three come together in his name, there he is with them to shepherd his flock until he comes again in glory. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song.
Sing, holy, 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 Lord God of hosts on high, your everlasting glory fills earth and sea and sky. Save us, in love come set us free. Hosanna in the highest, how blessed is Christ our King, who died as our Redeemer, eternal life to bring. How blessed are you, Lord Jesus.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
In perfect love, in our ways, we serve.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Thank you, Almighty God, for refreshing us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God's words of blessing. That word blessing means something special here in the Four Corners. Native Americans often look for a blessing. They want a blessing of wealth. They look for a blessing with health. They look for blessing on their family and their lives. So often, the blessings poured out on them are only those temporal blessings. But this blessing the Lord brings to us, pouring his name on us, giving us that real hope so that as we leave, whether it's today or tomorrow or whatever is happening in our lives, we know that our Lord goes with us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Let's join in our closing hymn, O Church Arise.